Hallelujah. Something has to break. We need to take a couple seconds just to give God praise. Because something is breaking in the atmosphere right now. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Are you worthy, God? You're worthy. Don't let nothing hold these people back from getting the blessing that you got for them, Lord God. Have your way, God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Have your way, God. Have your way in this place, Lord God. Oh, we thank you for it, God. We thank you for it. We thank you for it, Lord. We praise you for it, Lord. Ah, you're worthy, God. You're worthy. You're worthy. Something has to break. Hallelujah. Ah, you're worthy, God. My. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. Thank you. I want to give glory and honor to God first, who is the head of my life. I just thank him. I give honor to the shepherd of this house, Bishop John Porter, to Lady Andrea Porter, and to the True Heart Ministries. I thank you for allowing me to be here on today. I just give glory to it. I know that it's just an honor. We are family, but I'm just grateful that you've seen enough to allow for me to come and grace your pulpit on today. So God bless you, Bishop. God bless you. And I just thank God. Give my husband a hand clap of praise. That was his first time, and he did an outstanding job. I'm not going to tell y'all. I know Bishop John would just fall out laughing because they are close, and he was practicing, and the things he was saying, I had to keep saying, wait a minute, wait, don't do it, don't do it, don't do it, do not say it. So he did very well. I thank God for our two beautiful children, Anya and Keyshawn Ballard. I just thank God for them. And I just thank God for you being here on today. God is good. God is so good. Amen. He is so good. He is so good. So at this time, I would like you to stand for your feet. There is a word from the Lord, not from me, but from the Lord. We will be coming from 1 Peter 5, 1 through 4. Amen. When you have it, say amen. 1 Peter 5, 1 through 4. The elders who are among you, I exhort. I, who am a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that will be revealed, shepherd the flock of God which is among you, serving as overseers, not by compulsion, but willingly, not for dishonest gain, but eagerly, nor as being lords over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory that does not fade away. Amen. I have read 1 Peter 5, 1 through 4, and that was the New King James Version. And my title on today will be A Servant's Heart. A Servant's Heart. Amen. Let us please bow our heads for a moment of prayer. Father, we just want to say thank you, God. We thank you on this morning for your grace. And we thank you for your mercy, Lord God. I do not take it lightly or for granted that you allow me to grace this pulpit on today, God. I pray right now in the name of Jesus that they shall not see me, God, but they shall see you in me, God. Lord God, I ask you to rise up your anointing inside of me, God, that I will preach the word, Father God, in season and out of season before your glory. We give you glory and we give you honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 I just want Bishop John to know he was all in my sermon. I could just sit down because he done said so much stuff in here, he's going to start laughing. I was like, Lord, have mercy. But you know what? That means that it's confirmation. And I thank God for confirming the word of God. Amen. I thank him for that. I thought back to last Sunday when Lady Andrea asked everyone from the church to give one word to describe Bishop Porter. And we go way back. We go way back. And so I asked God, I said, God, give me a word. Give me a word that I could describe Bishop Porter. Because I knew him when he was associate pastor. I knew him when he was a pastor. I knew him as the son of Bishop Ruffin, you know, as a husband to Andrea Porter and having children. I knew him as all those things. And I said, but God, give me a word to describe who he is. Who he is, Lord. One word. And God dealt with me. He dealt with me. He gave me a word. He gave me a word. The word is servant. When I think of Bishop Porter and all God has brought him through, the seen and the unseen, the word servant dropped in my spirit. I know you all may be wondering, why servant? He's a bishop. He's a doctor. But let me tell you something. In order for Bishop Porter to be who he is and to have what he has, he has to be a servant. He has to be a servant with a servant's heart. Amen? And everything he was standing up here saying today is in his heart. It is in his heart. If it was not for the Lord being by his side, come on now, it is in his heart. He don't get up every Sunday because he want to. He don't come here through the weekday because he wants to. But it's because of who? Because of God. So it's in his heart. Amen? So when we first think about the word servant and with our fleshly lenses, so I want y'all to put on your fleshly lenses. I have mine back there. I don't need them to see you, but I do need them to see far away. Amen. I was looking back there early and I told Bishop John, I said, is that your son, Jay? He's talking about, I had to put my glasses on and everything. He said, no, Jay is in Atlanta. I said, well, to God be the glory. I said, that's why we need those lenses sometimes, amen, so we can see things in a distance, amen? So when we put on our fleshly lenses and we think about the word servant, just think about it for a moment, because sometimes people can come to you and say, oh, yeah, Lady Porter, you're going to be my servant. And she might look at him like, who are you talking to? You know, our flesh gets in us and be like, wait a minute, a servant. We could think of slavery. We could think of bondage. We can think of being stuck. But even the Webster Dictionary states that a servant is a person who serves others as an individual who performs duties about the person or home of a master. And we know about that. As being African Americans and our ancestors dealing with slavery, or a personal employer, you know, we feel like we being slave drives sometime on our jobs. A person in the employ or subject to the direction or control of an individual or a company. You know, we get stuck. We feel like we're being slave owned. You know, that we can't move, we can't go nowhere. But that's in the fleshly sense. So now I want to talk to you about the spiritual sense. Yeah. Let's put our spiritual glasses on, our spiritual lenses, and think about the word servant. When I think about the word servant, I think about humbleness. I think about freedom.
Yes.
I think about being helpful to others, devotion, to being lovable, to being dedicated, yes, determined, perseverance. When you think about a servant, you think about all those things. And when you guys came up here on last Sunday and talked about all the things that represented Bishop Porter, that is a servant. That's a servant. I don't take away from him being a bishop. I don't take away from him being a doctor. I don't take away from all of us having these different titles. But we have to be a servant first. Amen? We have to be a servant first. He said it that he wouldn't be here if it wasn't for God. So he was a servant first. Yes, all the everything else comes. Amen? Amen. Woo, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Because I wouldn't be standing here today if it wasn't for what? Being a servant. Being a servant. I'm not good. It ain't Tracy, it's God. It's God, amen. Peter was a servant. He was one of the 12 apostles of Jesus. And Peter was not perfect. We all know that. He loved God, though. That's the thing. None of us in here are perfect, but we love God. The Bible says that we all sin and fall short of the glory of God. All of us. So not one of us in here is perfect. Amen? Not one of us. And sometimes Peter gets that bad reputation because of the things that he did in the Bible. But we forget it was all a part of the plan. It was a part of God's plan. Everything that we have gone through in our lives is all a part of the plan of God. If we didn't go through nothing, if we didn't go through some things, we couldn't be where we are today. We couldn't be where we are. Peter is known for writing the two books of the Bible, 1 Peter and 2 Peter. But Peter was a fisherman first. He was a fisherman first, and then he picked up his cross to follow Christ. Let's think about it. All of us was something else before we became into Christ, right? Amen. I know some of us might have ran the streets and had some names out there, you know, and all that stuff. But now we are who we are. They used to call me some things, but hey, my name is Tracy now. Amen. It ain't Trey Dog. It ain't Trace this or this that. You know, it's who I am right now. I live for Christ. So Peter, he lived for Christ. He was a fisherman. He had to do the work, but he was an apostle of God. And we got to remember that. Bishop John ain't always been perfect. He said it. That's why I was like, oh my God, he is really talking all up in my message. But it's God. He has not always been perfect. None of us in here can say that we're perfect. But what we can say is that we're pressing. We are pressing. Amen. Do I have any pressers in the house? Do I have any pressers in the house? We are pressing. And I know that Peter's story sounds so familiar and sounds like, oh, that might be my story. Amen? Amen. Amen. So we're pressing towards the mark for the prize of the high calling in Christ Jesus. Not once a day, every day, all day, 24/7, 7 days a week, we're pressing. Amen? We are pressing. Peter's transformation from an impulsive and inconsistent leader of the disciples to a more charismatic leader was worthy of mentioning. Peter was a good apostle. No, he had his wrongdoings. He did things. We know that. He was the one that denied Christ. Not one time, not two times, but three times. But guess what? It was all in the plan. It was all in the plan. So the feature passage from Peter, 1 Peter, reflected the disciples' growth into a full-fledged servant. Yes. And I'm going to give you a preview and talk about some things about Bishop John, also connecting it to the Word of God. Amen? Amen? Amen. He identified himself as a fellow elder. So when he said, the elders which are among you, he was letting them know, I'm an elder too. Amen. You know, so I'm not a stranger. I understand where you are because I'm where you are. But he said, leaders of the church, demonstrating the community, they all shared as spiritual, mature leaders. Amen. So if you're an elder of the church, as Elder Wimberly, you are mature. Amen? Amen? You're mature. You have grown to where God has placed you to be. She didn't get there overnight. Amen? But it was a process. And sometimes we don't like the process. The process surely don't feel good. Amen. Amen. How can we be a witness of Christ's suffering if we don't go through some suffering ourselves? Amen. Because in order to be a servant, Peter gave us clear instructions. And those clear instructions was, first, you have to be a witness of the sufferings of Christ. Yes. So that means that we have to go through some things. We got to grow through some things. Sometimes it's going to hurt. It's not always going to feel good. I know Bishop Porter has gone through some sufferings. Amen. From having to start from humble beginnings, with beginning as an associate pastor to at Living Waters, to driving the church van for Living Waters. And I laugh about when I say church van, because him and my niece, when he would go pick my niece up, They had some stories to tell, Lord have mercy. But he drove that van, amen? He drove it to the glory of God. He wasn't thinking about a title, but he did what he had to do to get to where he is right now, to start his own church, to going from building, to being back in Living Waters in three rows in the back, from church family, to employment, to raising his children. He has gone through some things, even in his marriage. First Lady sat up here and said, it's not easy. Marriage is work. Amen? It is work. They're coming up on 33 years. That is work. And it's not because of how good they've been. It's because of who? Jesus. You can't make it that far without him. Amen? So I'm just saying, you can't make it that far without God. You cannot make it that far. When he was saying how long I've been at Living Waters, it's because of God. It's no way I could have made it that far. If you only knew who I used to be and what I used to do, woo! I know it is nothing but God's grace and mercy. God's grace and mercy. But God, I know the stories continue about Bishop Porter. But the thing is, he never gave up. He never gave up. He never threw in the towel. That's an example for your church and for Christians all over. When I listened to people talk about him on last Sunday, I was like, wow, wow. That is what we want to have when we leave this world one day. You want your life to speak for you. Amen. You want your life to speak for you. You want people to be able to say good things about you. You don't want people to get up there and talk down about you, but you want people to be able to say good things. And Lady Porter asked for one word. That's hard to give just one word. But when you think about all the attributes that you guys said on last Sunday, a servant, that's what you have to be a servant. Faithful. You have to be that, to be a servant. It's nothing but because of God's grace and mercy that he is where he is. And he makes it look real easy. Amen. He makes it look real easy, but it's not easy. It's not easy. He said that on this morning. It's not easy. But if only you knew the full story. I don't know the full story. I just know bits and pieces of the story. But the saying that says, you see my glory, but you don't know my story. Come on now. You see the glory. You see how handsome he looks up here. You see how beautiful First Lady looked. But it ain't easy. I know because she's told me some things way back in the day. It's not easy, amen? But I am so grateful and so proud of them that I was able to just be here on this morning. And when I was in the back in Bishop's study and he asked First Lady to pray for me, I was like, uh-oh. And then she said, okay. And it was so funny because any other time she was like, John. You know, so I was like, Lord, I just thank you for the growth. You know what I'm saying? God is so good. I just thank God for the growth. I've seen them grow. And I know that they have many, many more years to come. Many more years to come. And I pray that I'll be here to see what God has in store for this ministry and for Bishop Porter. I really do. I just give God the glory for that. I give God the glory for that. Because 1 Peter 4:12 says, beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you. Excuse me. As though some strange thing happened to you. In order to win souls to Christ, we have to grow through. So we have to go through to grow through. Amen. That's a part of a servant's heart. That's a part of it. So those sufferings that I was talking about, you have to have that. If you don't have any suffering in your life, then you need to take a look at it. Because we got to go through some things. You will not be able to tell anybody or draw anybody to Christ if you have not been through anything. Amen. 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 just like Christ expressed himself as the true shepherd in John 10. There were all shepherds of the flock God had entrusted to them. God entrusted this church to Bishop John Porter.
Yes. Amen.
He didn't ask for it. I don't think that he got up one morning and said, I want to do this. I know that God called him. I know that he was chosen by God. And I even remember when his uncle said on last Sunday, he was talking about God at the age of 5 and 6. Amen. So God already had his hands on him. He already had his hands on us. When he has his hands on you, you can try to run, but you cannot hide. Come on. You can try to run, but you cannot hide. God has a way of getting your attention. Getting your attention. And it's all for the glory of God. All for the glory of God. I want to share something. Bishop John, a long time ago, he had told me I would, every time he would preach, finish preaching at Living Waters or anywhere I have seen him preach, I would say, great job, to God be the glory, you know. And he would like, no, I don't take any glory for that. I give all glory to God. He always said that to me. He said, I always give it back to God. I don't take the glory. It wasn't me, it was God. And I take that to this day. When people say stuff to me, oh, great job, Minister Ballard. Great job, Tracy, this, that. I said, to God be the glory. It's not me, it's God. Because everything that we do, it has to go back to God. That's how we keep ourselves grounded. That's how we keep ourselves from not getting big-headed, thinking that, oh, it's me, I done arrived, it's all about me. And no, that's not the way it's supposed to be. It's all about God. And if you always keep it and give it back to him, that's how you're going to keep getting blessings after blessings after blessings after blessings. Come on, after blessing. He'll keep blessing you. When you keep giving him glory, he'll keep blessing you. Am I right, Sister June? I remember when you had the broke up cars and stuff, but look at what God done for you. I'm just saying, if you keep blessing, if you keep giving that glory back to him, he'll keep blessing you. Amen? Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. So you got to do that. You have to do that. It's not the accolades. It's great that people say you did a good job. I'm not saying take from it. But what I'm saying is don't get so caught up in self. Because when you're caught up in yourself, that's when you fall. But when you stay focused and caught up in Jesus, that's when everything will fall into place. Amen? Amen. So when somebody says, oh, well done, Lady Porter, what you gonna say? To God be the glory. To God be the glory. It's certain things that I remember from people. And Bishop John, a long time ago at Living Waters, preached a sermon, when you had suffered enough. And when he preached that sermon, I've never, ever forgot it. He said, when you have suffered enough, you'll come running, you'll come dragging, you'll come into the house of God because he done beat you until he couldn't beat you no more. Amen? So we all in here because we done suffered. Don't mean that you're not going to keep going through some suffering. It don't mean that you're not going to keep going through some trials and some tribulations. But when you're in Christ, you can go through it with grace. You might cry sometimes. You might get a little weary sometimes. But the Bible says, don't get weary in well doing. Because if you faint not in due season, you'll reap your harvest. Amen. It's harvest time. So you got to reap it. It is harvest time. Give glory to God in everything that you do. Hallelujah. I thank him for it. I thank him for it in due season. I heard Bishop say what he's seeking God for before the before y'all's church anniversary, and it's gonna happen. It's gonna happen. You're gonna have people come sowing seeds. Matter of fact, before I leave, I'm gonna sow $20 to it, because you know why? I am a true and firm believer that when you sow seed on good ground, it comes back to you tenfold. So sometimes you gotta do that. You gotta be a blessing to other people in order for God to do what he has to do in your life. If you're seeking God, sometimes you gotta bless. You gotta sow. My pastor says, sow where you want to go. And sometimes that's what you gotta do. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. I thank you. I thank you, God. I thank you. The responsibilities that Peter listed in the few verses function as critical qualities of a servant leader. They were charged with feeding the flock with the word of God. Feeding the flock. What are you talking about, Minister Ballard, feeding the flock? Well, every Sunday, Bishop John gets up here. Does he not feed y'all the word of God? Does he not feed you the word of God? So he's feeding the flock. Amen. Even when you guys are gone and he may be in his office, he's not only feeding you, he's praying for you. Amen. That's what, when I go to the next word, being an overseer, he's overseeing you. He's making sure that you're doing what you're supposed to do. Yes, he was hard on you on last Wednesday, but guess what? It's all right. You know what you're doing. He knows what you're doing. It took a big person for him to get up here and apologize for coming down on the ones that are always here. But it's okay. The ones that are not here, they're going to get it. 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 Amen. That's why you got to keep praying for them. Keep praying for them. When they come running up in here, you know, after they suffered enough, they'll come right on in with no problem. Amen. Amen. And then as a shepherd, he's not leaving one behind. I heard people say all the things that he did for them. But the one that really stuck out to me was the young man in the back. The Caucasian man, I don't know his name, Chris, but when he was talking, I said, Lord, have mercy. He looked at him as his father. When some of us don't have fathers or mothers, he looked at him. He said he had his back when he lost his parent. And I was just like, Lord, that is awesome. It's not about the color. It's not about the how you look. It's not about whether you're poor or rich. Bishop John loves you. That is God. That is a servant. What I'm talking about today is not just for Bishop John, but it's for us. If we want to be a true servant of God with a servant heart, yes, we can come in here and I can serve. And I can do it because it's just Sunday and I'm just going to come to church. But if I come in here and I say, "Whoa, thank you, Lord. Oh, Lady Paul, what you need me to do? Oh, Bishop John, what is it that you need me to do?" That is a servant's heart because your heart is in it. You love your ministry and he loves this ministry. They don't get up every week, every day. He don't get up just to be for fun. And I know it's not for the money. Is it for the money? Oh, I know it's not. I know it's not. I know it's not for the money. If it was for the money, he would have been gone. And a matter of fact, Lady Porter would have said, come on, let's go. Let's go. But it's because of God. And that's what I want all of us to remember. It's because of God. What we do for Christ is going to last. What we do for him. Man can't put us into heaven. But God can. Amen? Amen. So as a shepherd, he makes sure that not one gets strayed away. And then it also said Peter was talking about a servant. He even set an example because a servant is an example. You're setting the example for the flock. You're setting an example. He has set so many examples. I heard it on last Sunday in this church. These are the examples that we're supposed to live by. You know, sometimes in our life, we pray and we say, God, I need somebody in my life to be there for me, to encourage me, to pray for me, to talk to me, to listen to me sometimes. Amen. And what is he doing? What is he doing? He does that for all of you. And if he does it, he'll have somebody do it. If it's not, no, Elder Wimberly to do it. Or Lady Porter, I heard her in the back a while ago encouraging the young lady in the back. The young lady's still here. To God be the glory. She could have walked out. You see what I'm saying? They're doing the work. It's not because of the money. It's not because of the fame and the fortune. Because are you famous? Are you famous? Yeah, you got nice cars. You got a nice house, but that wasn't because of nothing good. That was because of God. He did it. Because you were faithful over a few things. He made you ruler over many things. That wasn't because of your goodness. That was because of God. He's going to do that. He said he will supply your every need according to his riches and glory. That's what he said. And if you do what you're supposed to do in him, he's going to do it for you. He will do it for you. And then he said, a steward over God's flock. So we're not supposed to, he's not supposed to come here and act like he's bigger than himself. He's not supposed to come in here and think that he's better than y'all. He's right beside you. Right beside you. If you need something, is he not right there with you? He has a lawn care business. He don't just have people doing it for him. If he got to do something, I've heard Bishop tell me many a times that he's been over there to do. Not just because she's his mother, but because he has the love, the heart. Amen? You have to have a servant's heart. And those outward responsibilities join with the inner motivation of willingness. See, you have to be willing. You have to be eager. And certainly, like I said before, it's not about power. It's not about money. It's about the willing vessel. And because he's a chosen vessel of God and willing vessel. See, sometimes some of us, and I'm going to be honest, we don't want to do what God has called. We try to hide. It don't work. It don't work. As much as Lady Porter says she ain't going to do this or that, she's still doing it. She's still the secretary or reading announcements. She's still doing it. You know why? Because it's in her heart. It's in her heart. If it was not in her heart, she wouldn't do it. If it wasn't in his heart, he would not do it. It's got to be in your heart. And I know that Pastor Bishop has a servant heart. I know that Lady Porter has a servant heart. Amen? A servant heart. Yes. And I'm just grateful for the example that they have in this church. And this is for all of us to have a servant heart. Yes. Leadership isn't about making our names known. It's not even about it's not about being famous, like I said before, or that fortune. Because, I mean, yes, he does. He's on the radio. He's not on the TV yet. He's going there. He's not there yet. He's going there, but it still won't be because of the fame and the fortune. When he get up there, who he going to be talking about? He going to be talking about God. One thing about Bishop Porter, he going to tell you about Jesus. I don't care who you are. He going to tell you about Jesus. He'll feed you. He'll clothe you. But you going to know about Jesus before he leave you. Amen? I know that for a fact. He, many a times, him and my husband would be, and my husband would say, yeah, we ate, but we talked about the Lord, too. So I know. He's going to take care of you, but he's going to tell you about Jesus. Amen? He is going to tell you about Jesus. And the most important thing that we need to know is about making God's name known.
Yes.
Having the ability to love, respect the people in your care. And that's what he has done here. I walk in this church, and I know that he loves this church. I know that he takes care of this church. And I know that you all take care of him and Lady Andrea Porter. Amen?
Amen.
I know that you do. And having that ability to love and respect people in your care, using the authority that we've been given with grace.
Yeah.
He doesn't use his authority to beat y'all up. Now, he might fuss at you. I understand that. But he's not doing it to put you down. He's doing it to help you along the way. Amen? He's doing it with grace and with love. I know that he doesn't call you out in front of everybody. But I know that he will call you to the side and let you know, hey, so-and-so, I need you to step it up a little bit. Hey, so-and-so, I need you to do this a little bit. A little bit. But you sometimes you calling them out, Bishop? Sometimes. It's all right. Even if he call you out sometimes, he doing it with love. All right. Look, y'all still here. You still keep coming back. So it can't be that hard. Amen. It cannot be that hard. And Matthew 20:25-28 says, this is what Jesus said about leadership. But Jesus called them to himself and said, you know that the rulers of Gentiles lord it over them, and those who are great exercise authority over them. Yet it shall not be so among you. But whoever desires to become great among you, let him be your servant. And whoever desires to be first among you, let him be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. Amen. I want to make sure that y'all got that. We have to be servants. And he, in the word says, the first among you, let him be a slave. The Bible says that the first shall be last and the last shall be first. Amen. So be the last person. So when you're the last person, God will move you right to the front of the line. And I'm a living witness. I've been last a lot of times in my life. But because of God's grace and his mercy, he put me in the front of the line. And it wasn't because of how good I've been, but it's because of how good he's been to me. Amen? So, Bishop Porter, I know that it's not you being wanting to be first, but because you've been in the back of the line, and because of how great that you have been doing the work of God, eyes have not seen, nor ears heard what God has in store for you. He is about to blow up this church in the name of Jesus. And I'm not talking about literally. I'm talking about spiritually. My pastor said it on last Sunday. These walls is not going to be able to hold you. I know and believe, and I'm standing in decree and declaring that on next year, you will be walking into your new church. And I will be right there praising God right along with you. Amen. Because I know that you've been faithful over a few. I don't know if y'all realize it, but 15 years, if you think about it, 3 times 5 is 15. Amen. 1 for the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. But the number 5 means grace. You have triple the grace. You made it to 15. So just imagine what God is about to do 15 more years. 15 more years. And 15 more years. Amen. So I just want to just instore in everyone on this morning to have a servant's heart like your bishop. He has a servant's heart. Be faithful. Be available. Yes. Come to the church. Be teachable. Yes. Don't think that you're above anybody. We all need to learn some things. Amen. Yes. We all need to do better, including me. We all need to do better. So in order to do better, we have to have a servant's heart. We have to have a willing heart. We have to be available for the word to come down and fall fresh upon us. Amen. And I just give glory and honor for the word of God. I thank God for Bishop Horton having a servant heart. Amen. A servant's heart. When God gave me that, I knew it wasn't nothing but the Lord. A servant's heart. So I give y'all glory. I give God glory. I give him honor for just allowing me to just give a word on this morning. In the name of Jesus, I thank you for it, God. You're worthy. None like you. A servant's heart. A servant's heart. Amen.